In the 1600s, the Dutch East India Company began trading exotic products from the East Indies, now modern Indonesia. This brought great wealth to the Dutch Empire. It also resulted in generations of Dutch people born on those faraway islands. They are known as Dutch Indos. Stay tuned to hear about those people and about their last generation.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
Our guest is one of the last generation of Dutch born in the East Indies while it was still a part of the Dutch Empire. I would like to introduce Ingrid van der Veen. Hello, Ingrid. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Now, the Netherlands made a lot of money trading the products from these island possessions of theirs. And how many islands are, were those the Spice Islands?
Most of them, there's really more than 17,000 islands.
Okay.
And only 11,000 is populated.
What are the large major islands then?
It's Java, Sumatra, Lombok, Celebes, Bali, and other islands.
Was Borneo part of that?
Borneo, yeah. But they changed all the names. Mm-hmm. They changed the names from Borneo and Celebes in Sulawesi and Kalimantan. That's what
so they're all different. But
they're
when I
different.
Was growing up, they were Bali. It was so romantic.
Right.
And now, what island were you born in and brought up
on? I was born
on
Java in Surabaya.
Okay. And what are some, I know they had spices, lots of spices to import into Europe.
Yes.
But what are some of the products that they were growing on those islands?
It's the spices are probably cinnamon, nutmeg, and rubber, and coffee, tea, rice.
Sugar.
Yeah, sugar. Yeah, everything. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Explain a bit about the Dutch East Indies Company. Do you have some information about that? I know it began like in the 1600s and was kind of the reason all this began, settling in those islands.
Yes, and then they took it over. It was through the Portuguese first, and then the Dutch East Indian Company took it over. And it's going through European, Indian, Arabic, and Chinese.
So basically, it was they were the shipping companies
they
who were
the
taking the products from the islands.
Right.
To these other places. And so the Dutch became then kind of the elite group because settlers came in there to live. And were they the ones who had the plantations for these products?
Right.
So would they get like land grants to come in and, from the Dutch government to come in?
Yes. Uh-huh.
And so who were the workers then?
The Indonesian people, yes. Mm-hmm.
And then, or what about, because they must have had stores and different businesses, who were the Dutch doing that, or were there other people in there on the islands who were doing those?
Yes, there was Chinese, a lot of Chinese business people, and Arabic, and the Europeans from, you know, France and everywhere. Mm-hmm.
So they were more the in-between merchants
right.
and things like mm-hmm. that. So your grandfather, now he had a sugar and rice plantation
right.
in
one
Java?
One grandfather had the sugar and rice, mm-hmm. and my other grandfather started the rubber and coffee.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Now, since there were so many different groups, ethnic groups in there, and I think probably most of them were Muslim, was there one, did everyone speak Dutch?
Only the, probably the people that were born there, the Indonesian people still spoke their own Bahasa, Indonesia, they called Malays,
okay.
you know.
Mm-hmm. So did you, then your all the Dutch Indos then were speaking Dutch, but did you know how to speak the other,
yes,
the native
language? Yes, we did, because we were born there, so we spoke that language too. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And was there much like intermarrying between the Dutch and the natives?
Yes, a lot of it, yeah. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Now, even though you were born there, you were a Dutch citizen because it was a possession of the Netherlands. And what about then the natives, the indigenous people, and even the Chinese and the Arabic, other people, were they considered Dutch citizens as well?
No.
They were not?
No, they were not, yeah. Uh-huh.
So I suppose one reason that they allowed the indigenous people to be citizens is because of the intermarriage.
Married, yeah.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Okay. So what was it like being kind of, in a way, aristocratic over there, because the Dutch were wealthy, and I know that you came from a wealthy,
yes,
family. So what were the Dutch Indos doing those days?
I was
days?
Very, very lucky, because my father had a business too. So we had like 7 maids. We had like 2 guards, and then we had a chauffeur sending me to school. So I was very happy there. It was paradise. You know, it was beautiful country and nice and hot. We went to school from 7 till 1 because it was so hot at 1 o'clock that you couldn't even walk outside. If you were bare feet, it's hot, you know. So we always had to take a nap. And we had like the maids, and after we take a nap, the maid had to change the beds again for at night.
Oh, so hot.
Yeah, it was that hot.
Oh my goodness.
So we don't have blankets or anything. It's just
year-round.
Year-round,
oh,
yes.
Oh my goodness. And then what kind of foods did they cook? Did the maids learn to cook Dutch food, or did you
food? We had Indonesian food. Yes.
Well, describe it, if you would.
Well, it depends. We have the nasi rames. That's rice with different kind of...
Lots of fruits?
Yeah, we have fruits too. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. The fruits, mm-hmm, I miss. Mm-hmm. There were so many fruits in there that you don't have here, but now it comes from Thailand. They grow, mm-hmm, it in Thailand, and they send it to Holland, and they send it here. Like the nanka is a fruit. It's called... It's this big. The fruit is this big.
And like a watermelon?
No, bigger.
Oh.
It was, mm-hmm, it's strange looking. It has like spicules, and then you have to open it up. And we call it nangka in Indonesia. But here, they have a different name. And you can buy it in the Chinese stores.
Hmm. I know, because I've known you for quite a while, one time you were telling me that in your home, there was a drawer with money in,
yes,
it. And tell about that.
Okay. We had a big drawer with maybe this much of the Indonesian rupees. So I usually take every day about half of it. And I would go to my friends and...
Have some fun.
Have some fun. We ate from the street. I was not allowed by my father to eat from the Indonesian people.
Ah.
Yeah.
So you would do that.
I would do that.
You would do that. And then what was it like going to school? Did you have private Dutch schools there?
No, we had schools. We had Dutch schools.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And then it was only the Dutch people that who were, could attend that?
Right.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And then about the natives who lived there, how did they live? Did they have little huts, or did,
yeah,
they live on your premises? Or?
Some of the maids stayed with us, and some of them had their little houses, mm-hmm, very primitive, you know.
Did they wear uniforms?
It's the sarung kabaya, they call it. It's the skirt with the blouse and, uh-huh, the midriff, mm-hmm, you know.
You were telling me that at one time they were going topless, and there were a lot of monkeys running around.
That was in Bali.
Oh, in Bali.
That was in,
okay,
Bali, yeah.
Okay. So life then is an Indo, Dutch Indo was very pleasant because you had lots of luxuries. And your father, he was operating a business, wasn't,
right,
he? What,
right,
what kind of business was
it's
that?
It's a business that has to do with everything that's textile, like batik, he did purses, he did...
It was a factory.
Mm-hmm. He did upholstery. He made beds for the army. He did Bedford Conference for the children, mm-hmm. and everything to do with material.
I see.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like even the bike, like the saddle of the bicycles, he did mm-hmm. that too. Mm.
So life was good for you. You had plenty of money and plenty of yes. things to do, and you were learning the Indonesian dances
right.
and having fun doing that.
Yes.
And then what happened then? There was a change that came. Germany attacked Holland, and
right.
the Japanese
attacked
your islands.
And Indonesia,
so,
yeah.
Tell us
about that. It was very scary, but I remember because I was very young.
Did they come in actually fighting?
Fighting, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And did you have soldiers there, Dutch soldiers?
Yes, we did, yeah.
What happened while the Japanese were occupying?
Yes, you? My father, they all went to prison, the Japanese prison.
Because he was fighting?
Fighting, or? Yes.
I see.
And then
was he a soldier then, or everyone had to?
Everyone had to. He wasn't a soldier.
So he was in a Japanese prison.
Right.
And then where was your family, your mother?
Mom and my sister and me were in, I remember just hiding a lot of times, being scared. And I remember in camp, we were in a camp.
A concentration camp?
Yeah, a camp.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How were you treated in there?
I really don't remember
that
much.
Did you have
food? Just scared, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had food.
Mm-hmm. You were in there for a long time?
A couple of years, probably, yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
And your father was in a different prison, I suppose.
Right.
A real rather than a
right.
concentration. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. What happened to then? When did you finally get out? The British came in? And
yeah, the British, but it was really an Indian. They call them the Gurgas. They came in to help us, the Dutch.
But they were, of course, the Indians were under the British.
Yes.
At that time.
Right.
So they were sent by the British to come
yes.
in. Well, that must have been interesting, then, having Indian British soldiers in there fighting. So they liberated you then.
Yes.
And then, so I guess you got out of prison, and then had the homes been destroyed and looted, or did people have a place to go after that?
They had a place to go after that.
So their homes were not bombed or destroyed?
No, the home was not bothered, no.
I see. Mm-hmm. So you went back home, and then was the Dutch rule back in effect, or were the British in charge for a while?
Well, after Japanese were not able to take over, I guess Sukarno started, and he took over, and it became Indonesian Republic. It became a republic in 1949, and the Japanese came in 1942, and then the Indonesia became Republic in 1949 island.
So then he took over from the Dutch then,
right.
because
right.
I think the turmoil following the war caused a lot of nationalism
right.
Among the people, especially the indigenous
right. uh-huh.
people. And so they thought, well, why go back to the Dutch, perhaps? And so they were thinking independence.
Independently,
and
yes.
So he came in then, and he took over, and what kind of government was he running? How were the Dutch treated at that time, the Dutch Indos?
Yes, we had a choice because the Americans, because we were thrown out of the country, we had to leave.
Wait, he threw you?
We had
threw
to leave
all the Dutch.
Indonesia. Okay. You have to become an Indonesian citizen or you have to go to Holland. And we have never been in Holland. So they drove us out of the country, out of Indonesia. And we all went to Holland.
Was it like a moment's notice, or did they tell you way
in advance?
It was
in a couple of years.
Oh, I
yes.
see. So, well, what are the things that I hear about of people just piling on boats
yes.
and fleeing and
piling
getting out
on
of
ships? But I was, you know, my father was wealthy, so I was one of the lucky ones. And he said that he wanted my mom and my sister and me to see part of the world. So he put us on a freighter from Indonesia to Holland. So in every harbor we stopped in Malaysia, then we went to Ceylon, which is Sri Lanka now, you know.
So while everyone else was fleeing,
fleeing
you took a
I
vacation.
Was on a cruise, yeah. I was on a 7.5-week cruise. That was very nice. Yes.
Then did your father still own the business? Or?
Yes, because I think he had a contract with the army to make things for the army, upholstery, the cars and the beds and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Just he had to stay longer. Was we left first, and then he stayed there the latest, and he just left everything. He said by the time he got on the ship, all the Indonesians just came to the business and took it over.
You mean they actually came and occupied the factory?
Everything, yeah.
Oh, uh-huh.
The sewing machines, we had a lot of
so
sewing machines.
So he wasn't able to sell it then?
No, nothing. He just left it there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, we're among the Dutch Indos who lived on the islands, was there a hierarchy in that too, or was most of the Dutch wealthy like that?
No.
Oh.
No.
So did perhaps some of them decide to stay then,
especially if
they had intermarried? So
right.
It was the more wealthy people who wanted to leave and go back to Holland.
Yes.
And then once they got there, were they accepted? Because I'm thinking they're refugees piling in.
Yes.
And they couldn't go anywhere but to Holland,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes. Uh-huh. So most of the people were like in a room somewhere in a family. But my father was smart enough to send money over in all those years. So we bought a house. My father bought a house there. But it was a total culture shock. Because you come from a tropical island, come in Holland, it was 27 below zero.
Not good.
Not good. And I thought, what are my parents doing here? Why did that? I didn't understand it. I was too little, you know. Mm-hmm. Why did we have to come here? Mm-hmm. And with ice on the roads, I'm just not used to it. We fell all the time on the ice, you know. We're
and
not
you'd
used
gone
to it.
To school, you told me you had gone to school barefoot.
Yeah.
In Java.
And we could, but not here, not in Holland. Mm-hmm. And then they called us peanuts.
Why?
Because our skin was a little darker than them, and they would ask us, where did you learn how to speak Dutch so well? Had no idea probably that Indonesia was a colony.
They thought you were just natives running with the monkeys, huh?
So I said, I learned it on the ship coming here, you know.
You were extra smart, weren't you? So they actually thought people were not well educated then.
No, they didn't know anything about. Mm-hmm. Some of the Dutch people didn't know that Dutch had colony there, as Indonesia was a Dutch colony.
My goodness,
yeah,
it's amazing. Well, then at that time, then was everyone had to be in Amsterdam, or did some move out into the countryside?
Oh yeah, they're all over.
All over. I read somewhere that 360,000 left Java.
Yes.
Alone.
I think it's more than 500,000.
Oh. Uh-huh.
Because 200,000 came to the United States from
after,
Holland. Yeah.
Right.
After.
Well, now originally. Because of the war and so many different refugees from all the different nations, the U.S. and other nations were not letting you all in. You had to go back to Holland.
Yes.
But then I think at some period of time, Eisenhower made a quota.
Right.
So many
we can come here.
Of you
yes,
could come
we
here.
We can come here. Uh-huh. But we have to be healthy. They tested you if you're healthy, if you can take care of yourself. Because one of my ex-husband's family wanted to come, but the son was a little slow in things, and they tested him, and they couldn't come. Hmm. So they were very strict. Yeah. Hmm,
that's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, and then did they have designated places that you had come? Because I remember at one time when we were bringing Vietnamese in, it seemed like a lot of them gathered in Stockton, California, certain areas. Was that the case with the Dutch Indos then?
No, you have to have a sponsor here, and most of the sponsors were churches. And then I think the first group of people from Holland went to the Los Angeles area, because most of my friends live in the LA area. And then after that, the other group went over here. the next to group San went Jose. To Oregon, Washington.
I see. Yeah. So they came in mass.
They scattered all over.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
But it was it something that the U.S. designated that you had to go to Los Angeles, or it was just because you got sponsors?
You got sponsors. It's up to the sponsors.
I see.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So a lot of the people that you knew in Holland and even, I guess, Indonesia, you're still in contact with them?
Oh, yeah. I have a lot of friends in L.A., a lot of friends in Holland. Mm-hmm. You know, just I only lived there like 4.5 years, but we have a lot of friends there, and we have parties there, and we always dance. And when I go home to see my mom, I always make sure that I go 2 weeks and we go at least to 3 parties, so I'll see all my friends. Mm-hmm. You know.
So you're happy people, because as long as I've known you, every time I've
we have parties.
You're going to a party.
Yes,
I feel
all the time.
Very jealous.
Because most of my friends were in Los Angeles, and they have more clubs. We had clubs. Like here, we have only like one big club, but in L.A., we had 3-4 different clubs. And then they have a party. Mm-hmm. And so I flew there every month to go to a party. You know.
An Indonesian, Dutch Indo
party. That's Indonesian party.
And when you're together, then, all of you, do you speak Dutch?
Yeah, we always
speak
Dutch.
Dutch.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So in your heart, you're Dutch.
Dutch.
You're not Indonesian, even
no,
though you're
I'm
born.
I'm the Indo. They call it the Indo.
You're the Indo, but
the
you
Indo.
Feel more Dutch
right.
than islandy. So your father now became a master painter,
I understand.
And we have one of his paintings up here.
Yes.
And you've been busy doing some exhibits for him, I think. And
yes.
Is he living?
No, he died.
Okay. They stayed in Holland, all but you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. My sister still lives in Holland, yeah.
So it's interesting that he did so many pictures of the Netherlands.
Yes.
The villages and the windmills and so forth.
Well, he started painting in Indonesia. That was his after work. That's what he did.
I see.
And then when we were in Holland, he had more time. He made... Mm-hmm. He did a lot of painting. As a matter of fact, this artist, this guy, the businessman, asked him to do at least 30 paintings a month. But he couldn't sign his name on the paintings because he wanted my father's rough work. And then on the side, he did this kind of a work. It's the Dutch masters. And he became better and better at it. You know, that I think it probably caused his death. Because he was so busy. Hmm. My mother always say, why do you do this? I says, how can you say it's not good? I love doing it.
That's right. We obsess with with our passions, don't we?
I was already in Holland a year. And my father said, why don't you come over? Because I had a straight A report card. He says, come on back, because this is the last time you're going to see Bali. You know, so I did. And it was like no hotels, nothing on Bali. It was just the monkeys walking around and throwing peanuts at them. But then the Balinese women were topless. And they just had the skirt and a midriff thing. And my father, being an artist, visited all the artists from Europe. They were all living on the beach. So he introduced himself. I'm Aso Halspoor. I'm a Dutch artist. And so I got to meet all these people. But then after that, it wasn't the same. The tourists came, Australian men did something, so they cannot do topless anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, and then the hotels came.
Very
big hotels.
Different.
Very different.
Mm-hmm.
So are you over here in the U.S. now, are you, all of you, Dutch Indos teaching your children and your grandchildren to speak Dutch and to do the Indonesian dances and so forth from the old days?
Yes, my children speak Dutch, but they're not interested in the Indonesian dancing.
Not
at all.
So they don't have little schools for that over here like some of the other ethnic groups.
Yeah.
Well, Ingrid, it was fun hearing about your past, and you're certainly having a lot of fun. And I'm very envious of all these parties, and I know you win a lot of dance contests.
Yes.
Ballroom dance.
Yes.
So Thanks for coming and telling us about the Dutch Indos.
Thank you. You're welcome.